Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to be able to welcome you this morning. This is the last of the major celebration Sundays on the Christian calendar. Today is Holy Trinity, beginning next Sunday and for a long time now throughout the summer and into the fall. Is that green season just called after Pentecost? Our Roman Catholic brothers and sisters call it ordinary time. It is kind of ordinary time. But today we're celebrating not an event like Easter celebrates or Pentecost, but sort of celebrating an idea about who God is and how we experience God. It's a difficult idea. More about that during the sermon this morning. But last Sunday, as we were celebrating Pentecost and enjoying that together as a congregation, and as the Waterloo High School was celebrating graduation, and that was a community celebration, nobody on Waterloo realized that the next day would be a tremendously tragic accident that would claim the life of one young girl and seriously injure another from our community. And in a community the size of Waterloo, people know each other, and this impacts everybody. I saw the hearts that were in the windows of the businesses here in town and know that everybody is thinking about this tragic situation. Two young friends who were out for a ride, involved in a horrendous accident. And one of those two young ladies, Kate Marty, died of her injuries. Kate was a member of our sister parish, Holy Family Parish. And so that funeral will be conducted by Father Borge, and that parish is Tuesday at 1 o'clock. But because of the expected size of that service, it will be held at the Waterloo High School Gymnasium. And so be aware of that. I'm sure that many of you will want to take part in that service because you know the Marty family. We keep Kate, of course, in our prayers, and also her parents, Paul and Mary, and her sister Grace. What a very, very difficult time this has been for them and will be over the next while. So keep them in your prayers. And then, of course, 3 weeks ago, we celebrated confirmation here at St. Paul. And one of the young people that was confirmed that day was Brindy Lauersdorf. And she was the other person on the ATV involved in the accident. And though she survived her injuries quite serious, and she has been at the American Family Children's Hospital in Madison, and I have seen her several times this week. The good news is that she is making real and positive progress in her recovery. The bad news is that it will take some time to recover from these injuries that she suffered. Her parents, Tracy and Janelle, have been there nonstop practically the whole time and really are doing remarkably well in a difficult circumstance. I had a chance yesterday again to see Brindley, and for the first time she said hello and goodbye and waved at me when I left, and that was all positive. That was good stuff. She's got a ways to go yet. And so we think about Brindley, and we'll keep her in our prayers, and we'll keep her family in our prayers during these difficult days as well. So, after that, it seems that everything else doesn't make much consequence, but just two things I wanted to lift up to you. First of all, the joint committee that has been working together between St. Paul's and Bristol Lutheran has made wonderful progress in establishing a possible future plan for ministry between those two congregations, and beginning now over the rest of the summer and on into the fall, we'll be sort of trying out some of those possibilities, knowing that when you set out on uncharted territory, sometimes you have to make corrections and turns along the way. But I'm excited about that, and Pastor Kim Knipfer from Bristol is excited about that. And so we'll look forward to how that all begins to unfold before long. And then one other thing I just wanted to sort of promote, and that is our Beer and Bible Study group that meets every other Thursday. And this Thursday will be the next of those. And we'd love to have you join us. It's a great group. We're always open to new people participating in that Bible study. Thursday, 5:30 at Empty Bar in the back room there. And we've covered a lot of pretty in-depth territory. Last week we talked about the story of Pentecost, of course, and speaking in tongues, and what that is all about, and what the Bible says about that. This time, because we're at the beginning of ordinary time, I thought we'd do something that's not quite so deep, but we often, when we're speaking, use euphemisms, words that are substitutes for other words that are more difficult to use. For example, for lots of people, the word diet is a difficult word to use, so we often substitute something else, past or lost, something like that, to kind of make it a little bit less impactful, perhaps, a little easier to say. Or we say the same kind of substitute words about lots of other things. Nobody ever really powdered their nose when they say they're going to powder their nose. The Bible has lots of those too. And if you don't realize what you're reading, sometimes it's hard to understand what the Bible is meaning if it's using a euphemism. And we thought it would be kind of interesting to look at some of those words the Bible uses when we might not catch what it's actually saying unless we know that. So that's what our plan is for this Thursday. And we'd love to have you join us. Are there any other announcements we should make? Yes.
So next Saturday, our youth mission trip will head out to Denver, Colorado. So we just ask for your prayers for that week of service. For those of you who want to come back with great stories to share with us.
That's exciting. And thanks much to Sue and all the others who have been working so hard on getting that organized and ready to go. It's going to be a good event for the young people of our congregation. Jill.
And as a further measure of support for our youth mission trip in the future, the pie and ice cream sale is coming back to the 4th of July, so if you will check out the table by the office, you need pies or brownies and more. And then there's also the opportunity to volunteer some time in working with the shifts. So I would appreciate it very much if you can head over that table.
4th of July sounds a long ways up, but it's not now. That's really getting pretty close. Thank you. Anything else? If not, then let's refocus again as we prepare to begin worship by hearing the bell ring.
Thank you.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
And let us pray. Almighty Creator and ever-living God, we worship your glory, eternal three in one, and we praise your power, majestic one in three. Keep us steadfast in this faith, defend us in all adversity, and bring us at last into your presence, where you live in endless joy and love, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We turn to the scriptures. You may be seated.
Character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the gospel. John, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus is speaking. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Before I begin this morning, I wanted to say something that I meant to say earlier when I was talking about the accident, and that is that it's been reaffirmation for me this week of how much misinformation is online. If you look for things related to this accident online, there are all kinds of misinformation, more bad than good. Read in places that both the young people died. I read in places that it was two ATVs that crashed. I read in places that it was two separate accidents that happened. Just a lot of really unfortunate misinformation. So again, always be careful about what you read online. The old adage is true, don't believe it just because you read it. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Holy Trinity is a day to remember how much we don't know. And to be reminded of that is okay. There's an old proverb that says the beginning of wisdom is to know how much you don't know. Some of you know that I'm a kind of an amateur astronomer. I just love things that have to do with space and stargazing and telescopes and all that kind of thing. And I think one of the things that attracts me to astronomy is that it involves things that boggle the mind. The size of the universe and the number of galaxies and stars and planets, the distances that are involved, and the strange physics that's involved in all of that, things that are pretty difficult to get a human mind stretched around, way beyond people's ability to understand an awful lot of it. And I think boggling is good for the mind, and it's good for our supply of humility too. Huh? Don't know everything. Mark Twain once said, when I was 14, my father was so ignorant I could hardly stand to be around him. And by the time I was 21, I was amazed how much he learned in 7 years. The beginning of wisdom is to know that we don't know everything. And today is the Feast of the Holy Trinity. Now there is an idea that's mind-boggling. Three persons, but only one God. The Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God, but there are not three gods, there is only one God. Difficult for non-Christians to understand. For Muslims, this is a major problem. Muslims not only say there's only one God, but it was the reformation of pagan culture in Arabia that worshiped three gods that was the foundation of Islam. And so when they hear Christians talk about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, it's very troubling to them. One of the reasons why they sometimes refer to Christians as infidels. It's also a problem for the Jews that God, whom they know was the friend of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Moses and King David, should somehow become accessible in this human person of Jesus and this incomprehensible idea of a Holy Spirit. Difficult, very difficult for Jews. Also difficult for Christians. Very difficult. There's a creed called the Athanasian Creed, which the Constitution of the ELCA and the Constitution of St. Paul Lutheran Church in Waterloo, Wisconsin, both say is just as authoritative as the Apostles' Creed, which we use regularly, and the Nicene Creed, which we use occasionally. But we use the Athanasian Creed so seldom, it's not even in the Red Service Book, despite what our Constitution says about it. But it has some interesting language like this. This is the Athanasian Creed. And in this Trinity, no one is before or after, greater or less than the other. But all three persons are in themselves co-eternal and co-equal. And so we must worship the Trinity in unity and the one God in three persons. And then this line, whoever wants to be saved should think thus about the Trinity. That's pretty strong language. Because of that line and the creed, an old bishop of the church once said, try to deny the Trinity and you'll lose your soul. Try to understand it and you'll lose your mind. One God in three persons. I don't think there really are any human beings who can get their mind entirely around that. But the point is to try, in words, and words can only work to a certain point, to explain a basic idea about God and about our experience of God. We believe in God as the creator of everything that exists. And so what can we, who are just creatures, know about the Creator? In the creation story, in the first chapter of Genesis, verse 26, God says an interesting thing. Remember, this is the beginning, the creation story. God says, I'll quote, then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness. This is God saying this before any other being was created. Before any other being was created, God said, let us make humankind in our image. From the very beginning, God is an us. God is an our. The God who created is intelligent and loving. We know and believe that about God. And knowledge and love require relationship. Knowledge and love only exist when they can be shared. God is, all by himself, a community, a sharing. And here we are, ultimately creatures brought into being by God, and what defines us as human beings most profoundly? Remember, we are the end and the crown of all that God created. What defines human beings most particularly is that we are also in intelligent and loving, and that we also, because of that, are capable of relationships. Since our experience is that God is intelligent and loving, and since we ourselves, men and women, are created by God, being created in God's image means that we're gifted to live in relationship with God and with each other. Being that we are those things means that there are some inescapable consequences for us. And John Donne, the old poet, said, "No one is an island, but everyone is a piece of the continent." We're not really human beings unless we're in relationship, or as Dean Martin saying, "You're nobody till somebody loves you." Knowledge and love invite relationship. Wise people want to share their knowledge. And those who love want to be loved. Because God is intelligent and loving, God creates in order to be in relationship. God created us for relationship. God is himself a relationship. In the Gospel of John, John says, God dwells in inaccessible light. There are some ways in which looking at God and thinking about God is like trying to stare into the sun. It's too bright, really, to do that. You can't really see anything when you're staring into the sun. And that would put us in our place, wouldn't it? So everything that we say about God is sort of trying to puzzle out what we can't really see in a human way. Fortunately for us, God understood that and became a human being to make it easier, not entirely easy, but easier. The wonderful thing about Jesus, about the incarnation, about God coming in flesh, is that God looked down upon us with his great love and realized that the only way we could begin to understand God would be for God to make the first move. And so the birth of Jesus took place, and he began human, body and soul, and experienced life, the whole of life as we do, but was experiencing that as God, giving us an opportunity to relate in the flesh and blood to the God who created us and everything else, to show us what we could not otherwise understand. And that was the Son, Jesus. And Jesus sent the Holy Spirit because learning about God is a work in progress. We need to have the teacher all the time, accessible and at hand. And we call the Holy Spirit God because Jesus says, there is another who comes after me. This is the Spirit. And he will fill you with the understanding and knowledge of all that the Father has given to me. He will give it to you. The gospel today. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. A community working together out of love, especially love for us. So the Trinity isn't really, in the end, a doctrine to be understood. It can't really be understood. But in a way, it's living our experience of who God is and trying to put that into words. God, who comes to us as Creator, as Savior, and as our constant companion. Three persons, one God. There's an old story about a man who goes to the east to a particular mountain to meet The person he's been told is the wisest man on earth. And when he gets to the top of the mountain, the wise old man is sitting there kind of nodding off. And the man shoves him a little bit and wakes him up. And the wise man says, "Well, what can I do for you?" And the man says, "Well, I've come all the way from the United States because I've heard that you are a very wise man. So what I really want you to do is to explain God for me so that I will do my best to worship God in the way that you do and with the understanding that you have." And since the man seemed to be sincere and honest and impressed this wise old guru, the wise man said to him, "A God that you can explain is not a God that you should worship." And that's true. And may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Yeah.
not printed in that version of the service.
Is it 104?
104. 104. Thank you. Yeah, the Nicene Creed on page 104. I'll let you stand. The primary purpose of this creed is to talk about the Trinity. And so together with the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
United in Christ and guided by the Spirit, we pray for the church, the creation, and all in need. One God, giver of life, you established peace through your Son and gave your church the hope of sharing in your glory. Enliven us by your Spirit to speak and act in love for the sake of the world. God of grace, Creator of all, you rejoice in creation and have given humankind responsibility for the works of your hands. Instill in everyone your spirit of care for the earth, especially in areas threatened by ecological devastation. God of grace, loving Redeemer, you delight in the human race. Move the hearts of world leaders to seek wisdom, speak truth, and care for all endangered by poverty, prejudice, or violence. Further the work of international collaboration and peacemaking. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Abiding Comforter, you call out to all who live. Restore severed relationships and protect children who lack trustworthy caregivers. Grant hope to those who are experiencing fear, pain, or grief. Be with the family of Brindley, Lowersdorf, and Brindley as she continues her recovery. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We ask you, Heavenly Father, to also continue sending your healing power to Mike Beyer as he recovers from cornea transplant surgery. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Holy Three, you are community and you create community. Build up ministries that support those who are isolated or lonely. Give endurance as we nurture vital relationships in our congregation and beyond. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, we remember your saints for their strong faith and witness, even unto death. Console grieving families. Stir up in us the resolve to end the sin of white supremacy and pursue the courageous path of justice. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, be with the families that are mourning today, the families of Susan Krieger and the family of Kate Marty. Continue to wrap your loving arms around them and send them your peace. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of every time and place, in Jesus' name and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts into your holy keeping. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Let's greet one another.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, O Lord God, maker of all things. Through your goodness you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us in what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen. So today, as we come to the table, once again, as we do in the summertime, we'll be communing by intinction. That is to say that as you extend your hand, I'll place the bread in your hand, and then you may take it and dip it into the wine that's in the cup at the center of this vessel, and then, of course, eat it. And as you come forward, you can also be reminded that to commune with the bread only has always been a valid option for Christian people. If there's a reason why you'd rather not use the wine, then just the bread is fine. Otherwise, dip the bread into the wine. And so I invite you to continue with me at the Great Thanksgiving. Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You reveal your glory as the glory of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, equal in majesty, undivided in splendor, one Lord, one God, ever to be adored in your eternal glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the natural fire. Deliver us from evil, for the kingdom, the power, and the glory of our universe, now and forever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Come, for all is now ready.
Thank you.
keep you in his grace. Peace be with you. And let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
I want to just add one thing today, and it'll be something that becomes familiar to us, but today it's a kind of a new thing, so I'll explain it. You'll notice that sitting on the altar is a little black box. That's a home communion kit that will be used to take communion from St. Paul's to St. Paul's members who can't be here for worship, who are shut in or unable to come for one reason or another. And we are training lay people from the congregation to do those communion visits. It's a regular part of life for many, many Lutherans. And in fact, there is a little prayer in the service at this point to use to prepare that. And here is the way it goes. Gracious God, loving all your family with a mother's tender care, as you sent the angel to feed Elijah with heavenly bread, assist those who set forth to share your word and sacrament with those who are sick, homebound, and in prison. In your love and care, nourish and strengthen those who will receive this sacrament, and give us all the comfort of your abiding presence through the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. So then, brothers and sisters, Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
And let's sit.